A new country with no taxes. How is that even possible?
Well, let me say this. Let's just imagine it for a moment, okay? Let's put it in our imagination. If there were a country in this world with no taxes, what would you do? I mean, many businesses would move there. We see people moving out of California to red states because there's no state income tax or less state income tax, right? People will move. They'll vote with their feet. So if you had a country in this world with no taxes, what would happen? Businesses would pack up and leave and go to the new country. I guess Elon Musk is moving out of California. Where's he moving? To Texas now?
I think Texas or Florida.
Yeah. I mean, so it just goes to reason, right? I mean, I'm just following the numbers, following the money, right? So if you had actually a country with no taxes, now a country that you can afford to live in, not like Monaco, for example, where only rich people can possibly live, but a country where anyone could move with no taxes, you would see a flood of businesses moving there. You would see a flood of good, hardworking people following the businesses there to get the great jobs. And you would find an uprising in that country's economy. You would have housing would boom. All industries would boom to support this rush into this new country, not to mention the brain drain you'd have from around the world. You'd get the really intelligent, smart Elon Musks from around the world, the Sir Richard Bransons from around, you'd get all these incredibly intelligent value creators moving to this new country. So imagine without discussing anything else about how this is possible, just imagine that for a moment. Now, the most important thing in any country is its economy. So right there, we've conquered big step number one, economy. The economy would boom.
So that would be basically a worldwide brain drain of the smartest people in the world, the hardest working people in the world, and the most innovative people in the world.
I think you'd have a lot of that. Now, look, I do want to say this. A lot of big businesses are married with politicians. They have a lot of political rights away, a lot of political advantages that blocks out competition. So you wouldn't just automatically get all those businesses moving to the new country. They're happy where they are, a lot of those, particularly the big companies, the big tech companies, for example, with the exception of perhaps an Elon Musk. But you would have true, genuine, what I call market business people, market business persons who are tremendous value creators, creating values for the world, and you would see them moving to this new country. Why? Because they get away from taxes. Now, you'll say, well, how can a country run without taxes? Let's dive just a little bit deeper here. I'm going to say something else. This new country that I am in the process of starting at a digital level right now, a digital level, with a 10-year plan to move into a land-based country. But this country, new country, not only has no taxation, but it also has no government-backed burdensome regulations that blow up industries, that destroy industries, destroy the energy industry, destroy the health industry. The politicization of our energy, that when I say politicization, I'm talking about political agendas, regulations backed by political agendas. There's only one way that can happen because no one wants those regulations. No one in the industries want those regulations. The only way that can happen is through something I call force or initiatory force. Now look, self-defense force is fine in any country to protect its people from crime, from invasion. Self-defense force, that's A-OK. But initiating force upon its people and its businesses in my new country is not OK. It's just not OK. Let me ask you, why should one adult have the right or be able to use force upon another adult?
They shouldn't.
Right. I don't care who they are. I don't care if they're career politicians. I don't care if they're regulatory bureaucrats. They should not have the ability to initiate force on a business or an individual of their country. That is just plain morally wrong.
And so up until this point, up into this new country, the only entities that have been able to use force or to use initiatory force, because among the population itself, initiatory force is illegal. But among the government to force its citizens to do what they want, that's never been seen in the entire history of all civilizations throughout, you know, human history.
Right. It's legal. It's legal to use force against other adults, businesses, citizens.
From the government.
From the government, yes, and only from the government, but from the government. And why is that okay? It's simply not okay. And I've identified that, and in my new country, that will not be allowed. It simply will banish all initiatory force throughout all society, including the government, which makes this a very interesting dynamic when you stop and start thinking more deeply about what I'm saying.
Right. So then how can government exist if there's no force? Because that's what basically government is right now. They force you to comply. They force you to do things. They force you to follow what their, you know, their regulations, their laws, their rules.
Right. And I'm going to answer that question, but let me just say something. That force that they use against you is for their own agendas, right? If you're a liberal left, it's one agenda with a certain set of force. And if you're conservative right, ultra-right, it's another set of force, agenda force, right? Agenda-backed force. So all of that goes away in my new country. That is not allowed. It's banished. And once you do that, and I'm going to tell you how we're going to banish it and how the country can exist. But I'll just say one very big thing right now. It would be a business at that point. It would not be a government. It would be a business. Wow. Okay, that changes things. And let's, because business has such a tainted, bad name now, and rightfully so. I mean, look at like a lot of the big tech companies and how they suppress free speech, right? Right, so that's just one example. There's many examples.
And a lot of the executives and leaders of those companies were politicians or go into politics.
The revolving door.
And vice versa. And then they have these secret deals with each other to, you know, pass laws and regulations to make it difficult for real competitive other companies to go out there and compete against them. And it just suppresses competition. It suppresses freedom of choice, freedom of voting with your own dollars, and making sure that that business can stay at the top without being competitive and providing that great of value that people would want it to remain at the top. So it's not a true monopoly. It's a government-backed monopoly.
That's right. It's a revolving door. You scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. It's riding the values that were built by original market businessmen. Now you have people at the top just riding this. So this new country would have, we can call it government to make everyone more comfortable because they're not used to this society running a pure mutual value exchange. We can call it government, but it's a business. And it's a business that's subjected to competition. If they aren't providing us with the best division of labor, meaning that we say, okay, we will tithe, and that's how the country will make its money. But remember now, it's a company. People don't like that word. It's a mutual value exchange. It's a private entity that is taking your money through basically an agreed upon, if you want to live in what I call the beautiful society, and I'm going to explain why in a minute, why I call it the beautiful society. If you want to live there in a beautiful society, you must tithe 10% to, we'll call it government, but it's really a business that's open to competition. The beautiful thing is you can do whatever you want with your 10%. You can put it wherever you want. So you can do your own research and you could put it toward this military, you know, to this judge, to this police force, to this. You can separate yourself, but most people want to just give it to, we'll call it government, but it's a private enterprise. Now, if they get bad, if they don't do everything the way you want it, your dollars will go to a competitor. Instead of you going to a voting booth and voting and being bombarded with illusions and misspeak and facts being used out of context. Instead of being bombarded with that all year or for 4 years, instead of that, your dollars will do the voting. Your dollars will say who has what, who has power, who has the business, we'll call it. Who has the business? It's a whole new concept. It's a new experiment that I will be initiating. You know, America was an experiment. It was an idea. And it became the best that there was in the world almost to this day. But now it's time for another experiment, another idea. And this is what I'm moving into. You know, I've written a lot about this. But in this society, and the reason I call it the beautiful society, is everyone, there will be no poor. Everyone will live like multimillionaires. You can come to my new country. You can come to the new country without any money in your pocket and very quickly live like a multimillionaire.
That's an interesting statement. So explain that. How can everyone be rich, including the poor?
So I'll just give you a little something that's already happened so we can get just a feel for what I'm talking about. Remember I said we're going to have no regulations. How do we have no regulations? And I'm talking about none of those agenda politicized regulations where they're backed by initiatory force based on if you're this agenda or that agenda, right? All that goes away. And there is a way all that goes away. It's through a supreme law that we'll talk about in a moment. Let's go back to the computer revolution, starting with the PCs, the personal computer. The computers advanced so rapidly that the government couldn't get its claws on it, couldn't regulate it. It just, boom, it just went. And now you're sticking in your pocket something that only Fortune 500 companies used to be able to have that kind of computing power. Now you've got it right in your pocket. Your smartphone. So that's an example how quickly something can move and how the cost can drop towards zero while the power, the computing power, advances so rapidly, ultimately toward infinity. So when you remove those burdensome, politicized regulations from all industries, the same thing will happen. These industries will advance. The health industry would advance so rapidly. The energy industry would advance so rapidly, values would rise, costs would drop, and before you know it, people could live like multimillionaires with very little income. Income would not be a problem. There would not be unemployment and such, because everything would be booming, as I explained earlier, would be booming. Businesses would be moving there. There would be nothing holding them back, so there'd be this growth and this creativity and this growth, and everyone, people would be in demand. In fact, you'd have a glut in people where you'd have to get creative and fill those roles with AI, with robots, and so on. So you have this booming economy, dropping costs, rapidly increasing values. So basically, your standard of living is going to be that of multimillionaires. Everyone in that society, is the beautiful society, is going to live like multimillionaires.
Yeah, and that's interesting. I saw Peter Thiel on Joe Rogan, and he was saying something kind of along the same lines, where when you're saying that the value and the power and the innovation of all industries will skyrocket as prices plunge towards zero. Yes. And alongside of that, that will happen in every single industry that you know of, and so many more that you don't even know of right now. And so back to what I was saying, Peter Thiel was on Joe Rogan, and he was talking about how when he was in college, that the other engineering fields, it would have been a mistake to pretty much get into engineering unless it were computer science, because computer science itself, he said, was kind of the laughing stock. It had like the least potential. Yet the other engineering fields, such as nuclear, is just so heavily regulated, it completely killed that industry. And so with the unregulation of the computer industry and what we're able to have today, you know, the computer, our computing power, information, AI and internet, that just happened in the one unregulated industry. So imagine what would happen, not just of what we know of, but what we don't know of yet.
And that's great. I'm glad you brought up Peter Thiel's name. Peter Thiel is someone who does not want to die as an individual. He's made that a goal of his life. He has poured many, many millions of dollars into life extension research. And there's a fairly significant group of billionaires who are in that same boat, who want to cure aging, don't want to die. Well, they're pouring, and I may say almost wasting, tens or hundreds of millions of dollars trying to do this research in countries like America and some European countries, where everything is politicized. All the health industry, medical research, is all politicized with these burdensome, force-backed, agenda-backed regulations. And in my new country, those would not exist. So my new country would become the health mecca of the world, because you mentioned the brain drain. People, these good, honest scientists and researchers and medical personnel would move to the new country in order to get the government off their backs and the regulations off their backs and really pursue the value creation that they're bringing to the people, to the world. Now, that's an interesting thought. People like Peter Thiel, heavyweights, billionaires, and others, billionaires, we may very well attract them once they understand what my new country is all about, what my prime law is all about, because that would be the supreme law of my country. So you could never have this dynamic that blocks, retards all progress in other countries, including America, and particularly in, well, in any industry, but particularly in the health industry. It's just impossible to cure these massively complex diseases such as cancer and heart disease and absolutely aging itself, cellular degeneration. It's just put it this way, they will eventually be cured, but not in Peter Thiel's lifetime in America or in Europe, not in these other billionaires' lifetimes who are trying to cure aging. You can just Google it, billionaires who want to live forever. You'll see a whole list of them, the most well-known billionaires in the world today. But if they understood what I'm doing with the prime law, the supreme law of my new country, they will realize this is the only place they could go and have unhindered research and development to accomplish curing aging within their lifetime. That is their goal. Sure, out here in America and around the world, we may cure these complex diseases, especially now with AI, such as cancer, heart disease, and aging itself, within your children's or grandchildren's lifetime. But if Peter Thiel wants this in his lifetime, if this other group of billionaires want it in their lifetime, they need to take a serious look at what I'm doing and the supreme law of my new country.
So we talked about wealth, how everyone will be wealthy, including the poor.
Yes.
And we talked about health, how that in this new country, it will be the healthiest country and the medical mecca of the world, bringing cures to diseases and cancers and aging itself and curing death. And so we got wealth and health. And so how else will this country operate?
Well, there's three big ones in the new country. There is wealth, there is health, and then there is safety. Safety. Look at what we're living in now with crime, innocent girls being raped and killed, people being ripped off, not feeling at ease living in cities any longer. even in rural environments, are getting more and more dangerous. But in the new country, crime would largely dry up and disappear. And there's a couple of reasons for that. Number one, one of the driving forces behind crime today is it's an easy path to money. That's one of the major driving forces to street muggings, to home invasions. You have it. It's to get an easy path to money. Now, remember how we started this in the new country. Everyone will live like multimillionaires. So that is the easy path, believe it or not. That's the easy path. Committing crime will be a much more difficult path in this country. So right there, it evaporates and dries up and goes away.
So basically, sitting on your butt would be easier to make more money than committing a crime.
Yes. In fact, when I did an experimental political dynamic 12 years ago, I believe this was the headline to my platform, live like a millionaire without lifting a finger. And it's exactly what you just said. You could sit on your butt, and that's easier than committing crime. So crime would largely dry up and go away.
So the motivation for crime will be eliminated.
The motivation, and then the consequences too, would be very swift and harsh for crime, because the individual becomes the greatest value in that country. And that's why there'd be nothing like racism or anything like that, because as you'll see in the Prime Law, it protects the smallest of all minorities, which is the individual. You protect the individual and you protect everyone equally. So you would have very little crime. It would very quickly dry up. It would go, in fact, it'd probably just become, in theory, crime, and you wouldn't have it in practice. There'd be no such thing as racism or any of the problems we see that politicians actually use to divide us against each other, by the way. It's all part of their tricks and games and their illusions. And they try to confuse the populace, and they do a good job with their illusions. So we're shuffling off to vote for them, you know, every couple of years, the big one every 4 years. And we're just confused. We're filled with these illusions. We're stressed out. We're upset. We're devastated if our candidate loses. And it's all just an illusion. It's a dimension that the world has only known this one dimension. And I'm creating with the new country a new dimension over here that plays by none of the rules. It will have no ruling class. There is never, because of the power structure of society, all civilizations that ever existed have existed with ruling classes. This society will have no ruling class. Everything is a mutual value exchange. And as I said, if I can't clarify it all in this podcast, I have a 650-page book called The New World that explains everything down to the most minutiae details. These don't intersect, these two dimensions. And we have to step out of this dimension into this other dimension altogether. And the tool to do that is the Prime Law. Here is the Prime Law, which will be the supreme law or the constitution of the new country. The Prime Law, the fundamental law of protection. Preamble. The purpose of human life is to prosper and live happily. The function of government is to provide the conditions that let individuals fulfill that purpose. The Prime Law guarantees those conditions by forbidding the use of initiatory force, fraud, or coercion by any person or group against any individual, property, or contract. Article 1. No person, group of persons, or government shall initiate force, threat of force, or fraud against any individual's self, property, or contract. Article 2. Force is morally and legally justified only for protection from those who violate Article 1. And Article 3. No exception shall exist for Articles 1 and 2. So there you have the supreme law of the new country.
And so that's what makes initiatory force illegal.
All the way across. throughout government, we'll call it, but we know, we have a little insight now that it's more or less a value exchange. It's more or less a business. It's a value exchange. It's a mutual value exchange. Our dollars will be doing the voting, and when your dollars do the voting, that drives to the surface the greatest values more quickly. When you shuffle off to a voting booth and cast your vote and you get stuck with someone for, say, 4 years, and then they're going to usually be reelected, the incumbent, you're into almost a decade of what could be very disastrous results to our country. When you have your dollars doing the voting by mutual value exchange, you are instantly putting right up front the greatest values in society. No one is stuck under and trapped under for a decade of something that's devastating to the country. The best things for the country just keep rising to the top. Like I said, there's this dimension we've always lived in, and there's this new dimension under the prime law. And I'm inviting our listeners to step into the beginnings of this new country. We will go for approximately 10 years as a digital country. And we're going to talk, let's talk a little bit about this digital country. But let me just say this. My plan is 10 years. But if these big billionaires, big boys, start getting involved and start coming to this, because they see it, this is their really only true route to curing aging during their lifetime. Like, they could do great research toward curing aging, but it won't be in their lifetime anywhere else in the world. But in this new country, it could be within their lifetime. If they see this, if they grasp what's going on here, and they come and join this new country, we might be looking at the whole land base idea sooner than 10 years. If we have these powerful, wealthy, influential people joining us, this could happen much sooner than 10 years. But without them, I'm saying this is my 10-year goal. So to lead up to that goal of having a land base where we can move to, where businesses can flood into, that can become the medical mecca of the world, leading up to that, we're going to start a digital country, with all of these principles in place, with the prime laws, the Constitution. And let's take a few minutes to talk about the benefits if you want to now join this. It's no cost. In the future, there will have to be cost because we're going to need to raise funds to make this big move of acquiring land and really working toward sovereignty. That's a big job, and we're going to need big funds. But right now, at this point, it's really, what would you call it, like a social container right now, with where people who understand what we're doing here, who are excited about it, who feel that this is the tectonic shift of civilization, who understand or who get this, come and join now, because you're going to learn so much. There are people now who are joining this digital country who have read my Neothink literature and my father's Neotech literature for decades. So they are going to be in this digital country, in the community, and they are going to be bestowing all their knowledge and information onto newcomers. So that's enormous. I mean, these people have spent thousands of dollars with me on these expensive books and ideas for up to over half a century now. And they're going to be here just offering all of this knowledge for free to people who just sort of stumble into this. So the value that people are going to get just from an educational perspective is going to be incredible. And by the way, people who understand this whole value creation and mutual value exchange, these are just a cut above. You know, sort of the general population. Now, it doesn't mean that anyone can't join us. Anyone can join us. But I'm saying we are attracting people who really are entrepreneurial in spirit and want to create values for the world. We're going to have meetups. We're going to have clubhouses. It's going to be very exciting. We're just starting this. So we're just launching this now with a 10-year plan of getting a land-based dynamic going. Could be sooner if some of these billionaires come on board because they realize this is their path, their real path to biological immortality. Really, I just wanted to get the idea out there. We'll get together in the near future, have another podcast where we get into more detail about this and the advantages of the new country. I mean, we have just scratched the surface with wealth, health, and peace, right? There's so much to it.